This conference will now be recorded.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. Welcome to this webinar on micro milling by Mr. Deshmukh of Silpin Machine Tools. I welcome all of you and sparing your time on this Saturday morning. Well, thank you very much for participating. I would like to just request all of you to make sure that your mics are on mute mode and your webcam is off, so that you know everybody will have everybody can enjoy the really good bandwidth. Okay. At CNC Times, we have started this initiative as a part of as a lockdown, when lockdown started, and so far we have conducted around 31 webinar. This is our 32nd webinar online. The beauty of our webinars that even we did online complete day programs, two especially I would like to name. In the two, basically it was, one was for on the masterclass of solid carbide drilling, and one program was on FMEA and APQP. It was a full on one day online program from 10 to 5, and we got an excellent response from the participant. So once again, thank you very much all the participants. I would just like to give a brief about Silpin and Mr. Deshmukh. Mr. Abhay Deshmukh, actually, he's a managing director of this company, and he has got more than 22 years of experience in industrial automation and control system. He's basically a mechanical engineer with a post-graduation in computer science. With his all experience so far, I think they have been very great, doing very great from 2013 almost this company was incepted. They are exporting also these machines to various SAR countries as well as even developed countries also. And he's also assisted by his wife, basically, Mrs. Deshmukh. She is taking care of sales, marketing and finance of the company. So it is a very, very growing company. And basically, brother, I am very fortunate that Abhay sir has accepted our invitation and giving this webinar to all our all participants. So without not much wasting time, I will hand it over to Abhay sir immediately. So thank you, and over to Abhay sir.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Nagesh, for a wonderful introduction. I have known CNC Times for many years, and Mr. Neeraj Vanikar, the founder of CNC Times. And it's my privilege to be a part of their excellent knowledge sharing series that they have begun. My first wishes to all is to stay safe and take care of yourself and your families. We are going through trying times, and I really hope that each one of you stays safe, and as the economy opens up, works towards a very Atmanirbhar Bharat, and we all contribute together as an ecosystem. What you see here is a micro milling, how to overcome challenges. I'm here more as a student than an expert. You can very well judge my expertise if I answer your questions, and if I'm not able to cover your questions during this stipulated time, I will always be pleased to take your questions offline and get back to you over email or WhatsApp. So please keep your questions coming in the chat box, and I will revert back to you. So let's see what challenges micro milling really means or brings. More often than not, I have interacted with my customers, and also, in general, we do a lot of R&D, and I think what we have seen over the several years is when we talk of micro milling, I think the first challenge that a customer faces is how to achieve super surface finish, as grinding may not always be possible. Because in conventional machining, what we see is milling is one of the primary operations, followed by some sort of grinding, heat treatment, and super finishing, and so on and so forth. But we may not have that advantage in milling always, micro milling always. So that's one of the first challenges. We'll try and cover this. So I'm going to go through the challenges. Please add if you face the same or you you have some more challenges. Of course, since the tool size is very small, you know, how do we really measure the productivity in micro milling? And because the material removal rates are so tiny, because the tools themselves are very tiny. More often, I come across you know, some customers who say, how to identify a worn tool? What is the tool life? And how do we really plan for tooling for the size of job that needs micro milling? Obviously, a lot of web-based utilities are available for determining the cutting parameters. So how do we really define cutting parameters for smaller tools? Because a lot of utilities that are available on the web or on the catalogs of cutting tool suppliers, they are for larger tools and inserted tools. But really, when it comes to smaller tools, do we go with the recommendations of the cutting tool supplier, or we go with the recommendations of the machine tool supplier, or we go with our own design of experiments and create our own tool library where we have our own experience sort of encoded into our cutting parameter table. So that's definitely a challenge. How to eliminate vibration, how to minimize chatter. I would also like to use the concept of the bite that the tool gets, and it's always a challenge. Smaller the size of the tool, smaller the depth of cut normally, and therefore there may be a smaller bite into the material, and therefore that always poses a challenge when it comes to surface finish. I think the next point is also very, very relevant. A lot of people, when they buy capital equipment, they need to know what CNC control is the best advice for micro milling. Because micro milling is an emerging field, you know, not a lot of it is into the mainstream controller manufacturers, I would say, offering. They don't really think about micro milling as much as they would make controls for milling, VMCs, plano mills, and bigger machines. So what is the best suited CNC control? What are the features that CNC control would have for us to choose when we choose a machine? What we have seen is 2D cutting of components, like in production machines, is hardly ever a job for micro milling, even though there are some applications where very small components are cut directly in 2D programming. But still, a lot of dies and molds are being made using micro millers and smaller tools. And therefore, the question obviously comes as to which is the best suited CAD and CAM software for my application. Tool life is a very, very important aspect, and the runout is an enemy of tool life. We can say not only does it reduce the tool life, but it also affects the surface finish and also the dimensional accuracy. So how do I do that when it comes to very small tools? How do I minimize the burr formation? How do I enhance the tool life? How do I prevent deformation of very small workpieces? We could have very thin workpieces, and then there is obviously a deformation that could come either by work holding or by means of machining. Then again, the option of going for a tabletop model of machine, and then the question is, do I do a a cutting using coolant, or do I do dry cutting? So these are some of the challenges. Of course, these are not limited to these many challenges. Micro milling brings many more challenges, and I would welcome questions or from all of you. So let's, having seen these challenges, let's go to what is micro milling, the technical definition. And again, here there is a wide variety available, but the smallest tool that I have come across is a 20 micron diameter tool tip, which is actually an engraving tool. And the milling cutters that I have seen generally available in the market from various suppliers are 0.1 millimeter in diameter. So therefore, I particularly define micro milling as anything in milling where we use cutters or end mills with 0.1 millimeter diameter and more, and limiting to about maybe 3 millimeters or 4 millimeters in diameter. That the application in micro milling calls for excellent surface finish. Since the tools are very small, to maintain the cutting speeds, we have to go to very high RPMs, up to 100,000 RPM or maybe even more, with air bearings, people are achieving RPMs to the tune of 250,000 RPM. The machine tool itself has to be very accurate and repeatable. It has to be rigid and stiff in its construction. And most importantly, vibration-free operation is desired. I think when you talk of very small tools of 20 microns and all, any vibration will result into poor tool life as well as poor cutting overall. The cutting tool material, the tool coating becomes very, very important, and the tool geometry has to be very accurate. And this is a very, very significant feature of micro milling. Material removal rates are extremely small. We have no comparison with typical milling or VMCs or even bigger machines when we talk of, because the tools are so small. Hardly ever the material removal rate or productivity is a concern in micro milling. Generally, the emphasis is more on surface finish as well as, basically surface finish only. No secondary finishing operations like grinding are possible. So that's what micro milling is. Now, obviously, what is the technology that is required from a machine builder's point of view? Because the user has a requirement of micro milling. His component is small, his tools are small, his design is small, his material removal is small. So how do I achieve that? What kind of a machine is required and what kind of technology do we have to consider? Typically, conventional milling machines or even CNC milling machines, they need up to 8 or 10,000 RPM or even lesser. But when we talk of micro milling technology, I think we have been able to come to micro milling only when spindles, integral spindles with high RPM and ceramic bearings and hybrid bearings have arrived. That's one of the more integral parts of micro milling technology. We can also go off with machine positioning accuracy of 10 microns or lesser, and with the use of linear scales, even more accurate. So we are talking about very less positioning accuracy. That's very important in micro milling. And with proper tool selection, people are expecting RA values of 0.2 micrometers. That's again a very important part of micro milling technology per se. I think again, I come back to what is essential is probably the use of laser tool presets to measure the tool wear. And also one desired feature of micro milling is that of a spindle load. If we could sense the spindle load, then the uneven chip load can be very well detected, and we could make corrections to the way we are running. And this is a part of Industry 4.0. A lot of OEMs are working towards managing the spindle load and therefore the tool, cutting tool load overall, and that is evolving in coming years. I think one of the most important parts of micro milling technology is the processing speed of the CNC control, the kind of algorithms that it has in terms of not only number crunching of the CNC program itself, but also the way the drives and motors are controlled in response to the feedback received from the encoders of the motors. It is desirable to have a very good look ahead, and because the tool itself is the weakest element in micro milling, I think we have to take care of the tool as much as we need to take care of the workpiece itself. So the CNC control must have very good jerk control, curve negotiating techniques, and a possibility of using linear scales. So this by and large sets up, I would say, the landscape of what is involved in micro milling technology. We have seen in the Western world, in the more developed world, as a lot of mass production has gone to China and to other countries, the developed countries themselves are doing more of micro milling, and they see a lot of opportunity in various applications in medical and dental implants, PCB drilling and milling, rapid prototyping, and molds and models. We have had the micro milling of and engraving of copper graphite machining, and also directly H13 and P20 machining in pre-hardened and even in hardened state. Jewelry mold, punch and die are also some of the applications. Godrej Aerospace and other aerospace players, they are looking at machining smaller components with titanium, Inconel, and aluminium alloys. I think that's also a big area where smaller components with micro milling applications are desired by many multinationals in the aerospace space. We have had a couple of experts in ISRO also looking at aerospace materials being machined in a micro way. Leather and textile obviously has some applications. And this is just a few items or few applications in the overall industry. There are many more. Pharmaceutical has tablet punches and braille dies. So you can see the components can be really very, very tiny. Materials that we need to be cut in micro milling are in the ferrous zone, mild steel, EN8, EN24, 31, WPS, D2, D3, P10T, Stavax, H13, hard die steel, even stainless steel, 304, all grades of stainless steel, and OHNS. Then we have non-ferrous, more prevalent in dies and molds in stamping area are brass. Then we have aluminium, copper in the electrode zone, then bronze, gold. We have had some customers directly machining gold, silver, titanium, Inconel, magnesium, and zinc alloys. Magnesium is done in printing and packaging industry. And then we have non-metals that are also micro-milled using materials such as PVC, acrylic, Teflon, nylon, wood, glass, and ceramic. So there is a wide range of materials, wide range of industry that is using micro-milling. So obviously, we have seen the technology that is required when we talk about micro-milling. What kind of demands does the word really micro put on the machine itself? And I think that the first thing that comes is the machine tool has to be extremely rugged and rigid. It better be made either out of casting or resin or granite. Granite typically calls, it provides very good temperature stability. And all, whatever material you use for the structure of the machine, casting, resin, or granite, I think ultimately vibration damping and temperature stability are absolutely essential, particularly with smaller tools. Cast iron does provide very good stability as well as vibration damping. However, stress relieving is required. I have not come across many suppliers of resin or granite structures in India. But a lot of customers, I mean, suppliers do give castings, and it really depends upon the grade of casting. One would choose to go for something like FG300 or GG30 as the material for castings of the machine. It has got very good tensile strength and also vibration damping feature. The challenge with micro milling is that it is very less tolerant of errors than traditional milling machines. In terms of tool life, tool breakage, vibration, the component getting spoiled towards the end of value addition simply because random vibration could come across. So I think it is very, very demanding on the machine tool itself, and we will later see the dependencies of CAD-CAM also on dependency of micro milling on CAD-CAM features as well. Another important part is that each one of the elements of a micro milling machine, such as the electro spindle, the CNC control, the castings, the motion control elements, they not only have to be individually performing, but they have to be performing also as an assembly. I think that each component being individually made to the best of world standard, but if the machine is not tuned properly for handling micro milling, then it poses a bigger challenge to the user. And of course the OEM also. The spindles we talked about range from 30,000 to 100,000 RPM with hybrid bearings. A lot of people want to use the machines continuously for two shifts, three shifts operation. And in that case, the spindle better be liquid cooled. It is desirable to have an encoder on top of the spindle, primarily because the encoder will help give a constant RPM and torque. Because in micro milling or micro machining, we don't have any feedback per se. So there should be no slippage of tool as it moves past, particularly the harder materials. So if anyone has got a choice of having an encoder on the spindle, it's a very welcome option that is available. It is preferable to have ISO 20 or BT30 taper. Balanced collet nut along with such a taper will help us minimize the tool run out to about 1 or 2 microns. It's very, very important to have as minimal tool run out as possible for tool life as well as dimensions of the material to be cut. When I talk about motion control elements, I am talking about ball screws, guideways, and couplings. They have to be individually very well made and from a very good source. Unfortunately, we don't have too many indigenous manufacturers of ball screws, guideways. They need to be imported either from Taiwan, China, or Germany. I think that one big challenge is really to balance between the service life of the motion control elements and the stiffness that the system provides, so that you have on one hand longer service life and on the other hand closer tolerances and closer geometric alignment features. Linear scale is also a desired feature when it comes to micro milling, if one desires very, very tight control on the dimensions. The machine tool and is defined by the repeatability that the motion control elements provide with minimum or no backlash. The electrical controls through laser calibration can provide certain amount of correction to the underlying errors in the mechanical thing. But I think it's a very, very important aspect that the elements by themselves are chosen to the best of industry standards. So apart from castings and motion control elements and controls, I think the real interface in micro milling lies between the tool itself and the workpiece. And this is where micro milling becomes extremely demanding on the runout, coating of the tool and the tool geometry itself. One could have state-of-the-art control, state-of-the-art CAD/CAM, and very nice strategies. But if the tool interface itself is not very good, then I think that we will not get the desired results. So because the parts are very tiny, we don't want any deformation of the parts, as I've said earlier. And run out at the tool results into an uneven chip load. So I think these are the, I would say, demands that micro milling puts on the machine. Now, let us look at the role of the features, roles and features of the CAD/CAM that one needs to consider when it comes to micro milling. More often than not, customers come to me with a question as to, you know, I have a model that I need to cut, a typical die or mold, or maybe it's a stamping die. And in that case, we need to look at what is the source of model generation. Is it a 3D scanned object, or is it something that has been created using a very creative software? And to what resolution has that model been created plays an important role, because I think the accuracy of model creation can only deteriorate in machining. So if you have a poor input, then you are likely to have a poor output. The mechanics and the machine is not likely to improve upon the model. So the model and the source of the model is a very important aspect when we talk about micro milling in particular. Then we have several file import export possibilities. I think one can receive a file from the customer in a particular format, but the software you have could be something else, and therefore the import and export of the software of the model into your software can be a big challenge. Data exchange and data translation can result into a lot of data loss. We've seen a lot of models getting torn or having gaps whenever the model changes the software platform. And the poor exchange of data will affect the accuracy of the component that is being micro milled. So the CAD system should generally not result into data loss. And one has to see several cloud-based utilities like MeshMix from Autodesk that allows us to repair the CAD model that that is received from the customer. And because the whole aspect of micro milling starts with the receipt of the model from the customer. Then of course the CAM software must provide several options of machining strategies. I think it's a key part, and again that is where we have seen that a lot of customers ask us about which is a preferred CAM software. I'm not going to name any particular software, but in general, the attendees of this webinar are requested to look at the options where several machining CAM strategies are provided. Machining strategies are provided by the CAM software, and that is where you will be able to optimize not only the tool life, but also the features that you are wanting to get in the model. Rest material imagination and rest material visualization by the CAM software is an extremely important feature, particularly when it comes to smaller tools and in micro milling. At times we have seen, particularly in engraving, a software that supports accommodation of tool size for the limitation of the tool size. So if I have a tool that is 0.1 millimeter as the smallest, does the CAM software modify the geometry to accommodate that tool? That is also an important aspect. Then tool motion has to be, I think, as optimal as possible. There should be several tool points along the curve, and that is when we are likely to get a good smooth motion. I think micro milling also deals with tight tolerances. Because the job itself is very small and the tool itself is very small, the CAM software must be able to provide very tight tolerances and allowances, and have very solid algorithms that generate extremely smooth toolpaths. We also have to understand that unlike grinding or some of the other processes, there is a lack of in-process feedback when it comes to micro milling. We hardly ever have any feedback coming. Then there is a PCN OS configuration that plays a big role. And then it is advisable to have integrated CAD CAM as a standard software from the same vendor, because one could have one CAD and another CAM, and again, there can be a data loss there itself. Again, this is continuation of what CAD or CAM feature we could have. I think the CAD system should address tolerances of 0.1 to 0.01 microns in theory. It is very difficult to realize this in the manufacturing itself, but I think at least the CAD software should have tolerances of 0.1 to 0.01 microns. The software should have a very good kernel and algorithms to take care of the CAD as well as CAM possibilities. Very good rounding technique should be a part of the CAM software. And the tool part should be optimized for smooth and accurate cutting. I've seen several software creating very empty, or I would say idle tool parts being created, and that results into very low productivity. So a lot of emphasis has to be given on non-idle cutting, as well as as many points as the CAM software can generate along a particular curve or a tool path, we get a better surface finish. I think the CAM software has to be smart enough to ensure constant chip load. This is something that is also an imagination of the CAM programmer, how to ensure constant chip load. We must eliminate air cutting, like I said earlier. The CAM software should give an updated stock model for the next tool path. I think most of us desire that there is no operator interface or very less operator interface. Once the CAM programmer has done the programming, there is absolutely no need for the operator to do any changes at the machine. I think one of the major challenges in micro milling is how to choose the right tool size. How many flutes, 2 flutes, 4 flutes, 6 flutes, or what level of tool size and how many flutes should I have, and how to define that in the CAM. This is also a challenge. And how to balance between surface finish and productivity, which two tend to pull a machine tool and the overall process also in the opposite directions. And of course, the CAM software, because particularly in electrodes, very sharp edges are required. So how does the software handle sharp edges? This is something that the user must also take into account. I will go back to the original slide and try to answer as to how to handle each challenge. But until now, what I have presented is the total landscape of challenges faced by micro milling users, and also the demands that are put on the machine tool and the CAD and CAM software. Probably 1 hour is not enough to cover all aspects of micro milling, and therefore, as I said earlier, I would throw the webinar open for discussion. Let more questions come through at the end of my presentation. But just a few pointers on probable solutions to some of the challenges that we have seen. I think what we have seen is a scientific zoning of big components into micro mill, sub areas, and a proper tool planning is something that gives us a very good surface finish. And I think that for many of the challenges that I have seen earlier, or I've shown earlier, a scientific zoning of big components, particularly when I am cutting ferrous material and even graphite or copper, we cannot just have tools be chosen randomly. Tools have to be chosen as per the definition of zone of a of an electrode or a component, and you go step by step. Say the biggest cutter is 10 millimeters and the smallest cutter is say 0.5 millimeters. I should have between 6 or 7 steps between 10 millimeters and 0.5 millimeters to get a good tool life and also very accurate curves and shapes and excellent surface finish in machining itself. I think one of the most important aspect that we have seen and we generally follow in-house is to use tool simulation to a great extent. More and more as we digitize, I think simulation plays a very important role in ensuring that the CAM programmer is designing his tool paths very accurately, going through the simulation again and again, because micro milling, the tools are relatively expensive and there could be a loss of a lot of productivity if we don't simulate properly. So my strong recommendation for overcoming a lot of challenges in micro milling is to use simulation very, very effectively. Naturally, in micro milling, one of the biggest challenge is to, like I said earlier, balance between productivity and surface finish. But all said and done, micro milling is micro milling. I compare it many times to neurosurgery, and neurosurgery does take time. So I think we should use smaller stepovers. By and large, this is not case to case, it could vary. But what we have seen is the stepovers should be reduced. We should use ball nose cutters for superior surface finish where possible. When it comes to really micro tools, it's a challenge to get ball nose cutters and get good tool life out of ball nose cutters. But the S-curve shape of ball nose provides us as an excellent surface finish in many, many applications. Just one moment, please. Yeah, so through micro ball nose cutters, they are very expensive and delicate. I think if we choose a very, we want to have a very nice surface finish, then the use of ball nose is something that I would recommend very strongly with finishing strategies and lesser allowances and tolerances, yet good enough bite for the ball nose to take. With minimal cusp, we can arrive at a very good surface finish. I think the two left hand side things, if you see, are also challenges for micro milling. The tool breaks or there is a burr formation on the workpiece. I think these are very, very practical problems that users face. So typically we recommend to use the depth of cut and very good check on the runout. And what measures one takes to check the runout depends upon their budget. But I have seen that tool breakage in micro millers is more often than not dependent on the runout that the tool has. Of course, the plunge rate at which the tool enters the workpiece has to be controlled. That's another software parameter that you have in hand. Whether you make a ramp entry or plunge entry, I think it is very, very important, because most of the time the tool breaks when the cutting begins. And of course, of late, many companies are there that can provide very good coating depending upon the tool that you are using on the on a specific material. There can be specific coating for brass, for aluminum, and of course for hardened tool steels. We have seen a primary and secondary burr on many components. I think it is very important to increase the grinding angle, optimize the cutting conditions, reduce the feed rates. Actually, many a times we have seen increasing the RPM and reducing the feed rates results into cutting rather than the material being flowing. Because whenever we talk about burr, we have seen that the burr is nothing but material has flown and it has not cut. If you are doing engraving, then you have to use helical engraving tool to get rid of the burr. I think one of the most important challenges that a lot of people these days are facing is with manpower training and the culture of the organizations. And this is where I think the management, or the, if it's a small organization, the owner or the supervisor has to spend a lot of time in triggering the imagination of the manpower, because we could have all the technology, all the cutting tools, all the right CAD and CAM software, but if the people are not trained in doing what I like to call as a micro imagination, then it's a big challenge getting results out of any machine tool, be it imported from overseas or made in India. I think the imagination of the operators and the supervisors is very important. How do we really do tool geometry inspection and the tool optometry? Again, it depends on the size of the organization and the setup they have, but I strongly recommend that the tool geometry is something that has to be inspected very closely by the operator, and if the organization can afford, they could have a very good inspection facility. Runout control, again, laser probes, and basically, again, the training of the manpower to control the runout is very, very important. Right from the time an operator looks at a model, or the programmer looks at a model, I think his design of machining has to start. More often than not, I have seen in India that people do a lot of machining directly on the shop floor, whereas I would say that if 60% time is spent in imagination and planning of manufacturing, then there can be very good results on the machine itself. So let us develop a culture inside our organizations where we digitize, we don't waste the tools, we don't waste the raw material, but we spend a lot of time in imagination and planning. I think it will give great results in manufacturing. Zoning, layering of component, understanding tool life are also very important when we come to micro milling. Proper fixturing as per the size and shape of the component is also very important. And the most important aspect is, how do we maintain a micro milling machine? Unfortunately, the maintenance of micro milling machine is more demanding than the maintenance of VMCs or even bigger machines. So I think particularly the spindle has to be taken very good care of. And if that is done, very good results can be achieved through micro milling. I am generally done with my presentation. I will go back to the first slide where we hold challenges. I hope I have covered. But if not, you are please open to ask me questions, and I'll try to answer any specific question that you may have. Nagesh, would you like to moderate and bring the questions to me, please?
Yes, yes. Yeah, definitely. So thank you very much for your very nice presentation. I think Mr. Shyam Sundar Bajaj has one question. He wants to know about the horizontal milling with round disc shaped customized milling cutters.
Can you come again?
Yeah, he has put up in the chat box. He want to know about the more about the horizontal milling with round disc shaped customized milling cutter.
Horizontal milling with customized shaped milling cutter.
Yes. Mentioned in the chat box.
One moment, let me. I'm drawing tools. Nagesh, I need your help here on the chat box.
Well, on the right side, on the extreme right side. On the right side.
Hold on.
Okay, I think your presentation is, we are not able to see your slides.
Okay, hold on, hold.
Yeah.
Can you see now?
Yeah, now okay. Yeah, now okay.
Okay, I think I've not yet read, because on the right hand side, let me see, I'm new to GoTo webinar.
Okay, next to participants, you can see. If you collapse that or expand, you'll find that chat box. I'll request Mr. Bajaj to, he can talk to us. Mr. Bajaj, yes. You please ask a question.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Sir, I'd like to know more about horizontal milling machine.
Okay.
Our job is small pieces, but multiple pieces. They are to be assembled together and then milling has to be done of various different shapes.
Okay. So,
the cutters are disc type cutters.
Disc type cutters, and you would like to have the axis horizontal, machine and assembly. I think Mr. Bajaj, I will take this question offline because I am primarily talking about spindles that are vertical in direction.
Right,
yeah,
sir.
But if these are horizontal, you are more than welcome to send me an email with your drawings, and I'll definitely help you. I personally am not an expert on horizontal machines per se, but still, okay. Looking at the specific tool geometry and the components, I will give you my opinion on that.
Okay, on which email ID should I send?
I will send it to Mr. Nagesh and he'll share it with you, sir. Nagesh has it, but I will share it to you. Hold on.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, what I will do, I will put his email ID in the chat box. Yeah, I think it is, I will just put it in the chat. Okay, I'll just put it in the chat box.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Next, any other question? Yeah, I think Mr. Atmaram, you can go ahead with your question.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir, yes.
See, we are not making any micro milling as such. At the same time, we want a smaller slottings in fasteners, like bolts, small bolts, where now groove is to be taken.
Yeah.
So without disturbing the parent, threads. At the same time, we are doing, C-value items. We don't have much budget to spend on the heavy capital goods.
Yes.
And our limitations are only up to 1.5 mm width and 1.5 mm depth slots. Slot length is to around maybe 10 to 15 mm length only. This is the standard slots we are making on fasteners, on external threads.
Yeah.
So we need the setup should be economical and the production oriented. This only in automobile parts. We don't have much budget to spend on everything. Yeah. I need to have Mr. Deshmukh's view on this subject. As such, we are not having any machine setup. We are going for machine setup. So I thought this will be ideal to seek advice of Mr. Deshmukh.
Yeah. Sir, this is Abhay Deshmukh. I understand that fasteners are not a very high value item that you can use a very expensive machine tool to make that slot. So you are absolutely right. I think these pieces are required in thousands and millions, and therefore cost work has to be very low. And the slot that you are talking about, I am not sure if it can be really milled on the kind of machines I am talking about. So what I am suggesting here or what I have presented here is hardly useful in production machines.
We need to take your views on this subject, no?
Yeah, of course. No, sir, I think, you probably need material handling and a simple like a slit kind of thin cutter that sort of passes through the head of the fastener to make the groove you are talking about. So it is a combination of material handling and machining, and that is a low cost automation machine you are looking for. I can imagine a few things with a vibratory feed ball that feeds the component, and there is a cutter that makes the groove. So I can conceptualize it, but not able to present to you right now.
This is a production in the sense we don't want a huge production, like our difficulty is already with the great difficulty we are forming external threads with certain accuracies.
Yes.
Those threads are getting disturbed during slot milling.
Yeah.
That is what we want. We want to eliminate that only. The production wise we can contribute. We can compromise on the batch quantity. Like that is not a big thing.
What is your typical batch size, sir?
So like no, the 8 mm bolts. Like it's only bolts.
Yeah.
So we are milling the milling on the threads. We are milling to just to have an external lock, like extra lock, like something like that after assembling the nut, like.
Yeah, so sir. I can probably give you once I see the the component drawing or maybe photographs, I may be able to share something more with you than just talk without having the drawing or the component with me. I sort of get an idea, but I think I will want to see the drawing and the photographs.
Yes sir. I'll write to you separately.
Yes sir, please.
About my requirement. I just understood what is micro milling. You just told me A to Z about it.
Yes sir.
But this is helpful to us. Still, we can take your viewpoint on this particular subject and we can go about our production.
Absolutely, sir. Whatever I could advise you, consult with you, provide my experience, I will do that.
Yeah. Now, I have seen your machines in a lot of exhibitions and I am very much impressed. That is the reason why I just joined in today's session. Anyway, thanks, Mr. Deshmukh, and nice of you.
Yes, thank you, sir. Thank you for taking out your time.
Yeah.
Okay, I think next question is from Mr. Senthil Murugan. You can go ahead with your question, Mr. Senthil.
Yes, sir, Mr. Senthil.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, now you are.
Hello. Yes, sir. I am from the supplier, sir. That lubricant supplier.
Yes.
I am from lubricant supplier side. What type of lubricant you are suggested to milling, sir, for getting better surface?
You mean the cutting oil?
Yes, sir.
I will have to check with my people. I don't exactly have what, but we use something that we buy from Balzers. I don't know what grade exactly, but I will let you know.
Okay, sir. Yeah. What are the recommendations? I know, that's why I'm asking.
Okay, we generally, the specific grade cut off emulsion based cutting, I will check with Balzers what type number and get back to you on that. But I know for sure we are using it from Balzers.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Any more questions? Any
other question? Yes. Any other question from anybody? I have already mentioned the email ID of Mr. Abhay Deshmukh in the chat box. So you can note it down. And if you have any queries, you can always send your questions to him. He will be happy to answer that. So I think if anybody has got any question right now, we can take it now or we conclude it for the day.
Yeah, I think I'm open to either thing, Nagesh.
And yes.
Yeah.
So, okay. I think there's one question from Mr. Yogendra.
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know how significant. Okay. What is the encoder significance in spindle? Okay.
No, it's a very, I think it is very, very significant in micro milling that we have encoder on the spindle. You see what happens is the spindle in a micro milling machine where we get 30,000 to maybe 100,000 RPM, you will see that unlike mechanical spindles at that high RPM and smaller tool, the moment the tool faces little larger load than what it is used to, a momentary drop in RPM is likely to happen. And that is where the tool may slip over or it may chip off. So both these things you don't want. And the spindle does not stop, but it can tend to stop. And since it tends to stop, and if there is even a 5 or 10% reduction in the RPM because there is no feedback of the encoder, then the drop in the spindle RPM or torque can result into poor surface finish because there is slippage at the tool. And therefore, we strongly recommend that you use an encoder on the spindle as well as a vector control drive that differentiate between magnetizing current of the spindle and the torque producing current of the spindle. So if you have a good torque, then the speed is not likely to drop. And because the speed doesn't drop, and because you have chosen good cutting parameters, your surface finish is likely to be good. So we strongly recommend that you use an encoder on the spindle. I hope that answers the question.
Mr. Yogendra asking one more question, that what are the grades of cast iron base? I am not able to answer.
So you have mentioned SG300 and something GG30 or what, cast iron based.
Yeah.
So yeah. GG30 is the correct or some letter is different, G or D?
No, GG. See, it is the German standard. Actually, FG300 is what we grade in India, but generally in Europe, they say GG30, particularly Germany. So I think they both have the same composition. And so I would say that FG300 is what we get, but initially we got something as low as FG220 also. But we've seen that FG300 has good tensile strength and also relatively better machinability and also temperature stability. So I think you can get any grade from FG200 to FG300, depending upon your supplier.
Okay. Sir, as you have mentioned, the RPM is reading from 30,000 to 100,000.
Yes.
So on that such a high RPM, the tool geometry or the shank dia and the outmost point dia, how we have to choose the shank dia for rigidity of that tool, otherwise it will get wobble due to centrifugal force of spindle.
Yes, actually you bring up the
for choosing of while deciding the geometry, how much shank dia, how much taper distance, or how much overhanging distance is required for finalizing the geometry of the tool.
Sir, you are absolutely right. I think the process control of tool geometry, tool overhang, inspection of the tool. So you will see in one of my last slides, I mentioned that what kind of tool metrology you have and optometry also. So it becomes very, very critical when you go towards, you know, anything above 60,000 RPM also. Things are relatively okay at around 30,000 RPM, but when we go higher RPM, the source of the carbide tools and also the collet chuck and the collet nut, this is very, very important. They have to be balanced. They have to have very regular geometry, and most importantly, when you go about things like 100,000 RPM, you really cannot afford to have tool overhangs That are in excess of maybe 30 millimeters also. I think 30 millimeters is also very high, even if the tool shank size is around 6 millimeters. So, you know, from 6 to going down to 0.5 or something, it's very difficult. So, typically, we have used tool shank sizes of 3 to 4 millimeters and narrow it down to the final tip size and limit the overhang to between 25 to 30 millimeters actually. I have not seen applications where you need 100,000 RPM yet go deep to more than 50 millimeters. So I think you are right that you have to control the tool overhang and have a balanced tool geometry so that we don't get wobble, chatter, vibration at the tool itself. And this should not disturb the air bearings of the spindle at high RPM. So the answer is have a nice source and probably get tools from reliable sources. But I to answer your question straight, between 3 to 4 millimeters is the tool shank size. That's all I can say. Because higher than that, you may get rigidity. But when you come down to 0.5 millimeters as diameter, then the neck becomes too long. So I think, you know, if you go to tool supplier, I did not want to name anybody, but still Spinks or Detron, these are some of the suppliers who provide very nice tools that are balanced for high RPM.
Okay, so there's a question from Mr. Jayakrishna. Any tips on improving finish in engraving of copper machining?
I think copper is a very tricky thing. I would personally say that, you know, if you buy copper from reliable sources, because when we say copper, you get all kinds of copper. There is commercial grade copper and then less oxidation copper. We have got very good results with copper that is imported from Germany. And it is sad state, but I would personally say that if the downstream process of EDM is very important, and if you want really super surface finish, then buy the raw material from a very reliable source. And I don't know what you use as cutting coolant, but at times using kerosene can give you, or diesel can give you little better results than emulsion based water coolants. So these are some of my tips, and of course very sharp tools and optimized cutting parameters. So besides the raw material, I think that all other tips will have to be based upon the geometry that we are talking about.
Okay, I think with this we don't have any question right now in the chat box. So we will conclude now. So thank you, Mr. Deshmukh. Thank you very much for your very enlightening webinar on the micro milling. And thank you, participants, once again, taking your time on Saturday. Thank you once again.
So thank you.
We conclude this now.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Bye.